and therefore we get this inequality. So this minus third of this inequality here on the right is a function of R and L. But an equivalent formulation is that you replace this term here by this term equivalently, with this is the volume of this tube of radius R of that gamma. And the volume of this, well, of course, the tube is itself lives in the manifold itself. So if you replace this volume K by just the volume of the manifold, then you get an equation involving the cosmic R and the filled manifold. And therefore, in that way, you get a lower bound for the, well, you get a lower bound for the manifold in terms of the cusp volume and the cusp volume and R. So, but I should say that this work was based on early work of Abel, where instead of finding metrics with the scalar curvature condition, but instead of finding metrics with the scalar curvature condition, you find metric with the Ricci curvature condition. Then you can apply sort of an inequality of Boland, Connell, and Suto. But Boland, Connell, Suto theorem is the theorem about open manifolds. But the foundational theorem in the subject is due to Besson, Courtois, Gallo, where they prove the inequality of that volume for closed manifolds, which sort of led, which was, you know, the celebrated work in the solution of Verloff's minimal volume conjecture for closed Verloff's manifolds. So let me just say the corollary of this. Well, a corollary of this Egel-Brumfield theorem, using Kermit, is that if n is a closed third volume 3 manifold, and its volume is about 9.428, which is slightly higher than the Weeks manifold, then this manifold is obtained by filling the 1 cusp third volume 3 manifold with volume of 2.848. So therefore, if you figure out all the 1 cusp manifolds of volume of 2.848 and understand the filling, then you attempt to find the smallest volume manifold. So I should mention this involves a packing estimate of Andrew Pegworski, where, remember, we took this term here and replaced it by n. And also, it needs this estimate for volume, for the two radius estimate of the sphere with Meyerhoff and Engel first. So, and I should also, there are experts in the audience cringing when they see this discussion, because Perlman's work is about Ricci flow and closed manifolds. And actually, when I make this discussion here, I was making assertion about Ricci flow and the cusp manifold. But the reality is that, thanks to Bill, that these cusp manifolds, the original cusp manifold, is approximated Verloff's Hausdorff limit by closed manifolds. And anyway, you play for the same game. We have a closed manifold, which has a tube about an extremely tiny geometrically, it's almost like a cusp manifold, and you can actually make estimates like this based on closed manifolds. So, technically, this is really the idea that you probably have to a closed manifold, and you can do sort of an approximation. So I want to now explain how to, we want to take it to the next level. I mean, how to find the smallest closed manifold, and thanks to Egel-Brumfield, it's we need to understand fillings on manifolds with one plus manifold prior to 2.848. So the question is, give you a hint now, just give you an intuition of how you might go about doing such a thing. So here is a cusp diagram for a particular one plus parabolic manifold in just notation M011. And so here's a basic fact, which is that the volume of a cusp is exactly equal to one half of the area of the boundary torus. So therefore, if you have a one cusp manifold, and if you look at it, say, maximal cusp, the cusp is pushed out so it touches itself, and that cusp had big area, well, then you'd be very happy. I mean, so therefore, if you get one cusp manifold with very big cusps, then you're in good shape. On the other hand, if you have cusps which are kind of smallish, but on the other hand, if you're looking out from the cusp, you don't see, you just see a lot of blank space. I mean, this is the diagram of a maximal cusp, so you have a cusp, you push it down, and eventually it touches itself. So it's touching itself along these four spots. But it could very well be like a lot of empty space in the middle. So if you have a lot of empty space in the middle, then you could find lots of volume outside the cusp. So at least at the heuristic level, that if you have a smallish volume, one cusp manifold, it's going to have to have, well, intuitively, it's expected to have a smallish fundamental domain. And also, when you look at another horrible, translates another fundamental group, it should sort of fill in this, you should see some fairly large balls. So here's where this idea of the Morse theory that is sort of discovered by Paul Gray comes in, which is that if you have a Harvard wall, so that's sort of like the neighborhood of infinity, and now you can make it grow a little bit, then it sort of touches itself, and the standard Morse theory way is that every time it touches itself, as it gets bigger, that's sort of creation of one handle. And then when you pick it up a little more, you get a little more, then you get to the higher dimensional handles, and eventually it sort of builds up a whole space, you have this handle structure in the manifold. And so therefore, if you look at this picture here, that, I mean, here's where they're touching, so there's already one handle here. But you look at my size, like this, which is a little bit smaller. Well, you can see that intuitively, at least, there's ultimately going to be one handle here. And I mean, this also may be big enough that this requires onto one handle here. So for the biggest size, you could feel on the inside that there's going to be one handle. On the other hand, here you can see, like, here's like three carnivals that are packed in really close together. So you can see when the expansion of the morph, you know, when the cusp expands, it's almost guaranteed to be a two-handle right here. So like right here, it's two handles. And so therefore, you know, when you stare at these pictures long enough, then you can sort of see, just jumping out at you, the handle structure. So therefore, but let me just point out that this two-handle is going to be valence three. Here it could be like a little one-handle here, one-handle here, one-handle here. And this two-handle, when it fills in, it could be valence three. So the valence three two-handles should play a special role in this discussion. And that leads to this idea of the mom complexity, which is, so this is like a really simple definition, which is, if you have a manifold with a torus boundary, or two torus boundaries at least, or a manifold boundary in the toroid, then the we'll call mom complexity, it's like you start with this thing, and if you put in, you build a manifold by putting in some number one handle, and then putting in some number two handle, and then the mom complexity is the minimal number of handles you need, that is the minimal n, such that you need the smallest number of the manifolds you build by adding n one handle to n two handle to valence three, or valence three means the two handles run over one handle three times. So that leads to a measure of complexity on the three manifold, which is that if given any three manifolds, they close, or one cusp, whatever, then you can look inside of that three manifold, all the sort of manifolds you get by just drilling out solid toroid. And if you draw out, if you close the manifold, draw out two solid toroid, then you have a manifold, two boundary components. And so the mom number is the smallest n, that has sort of like a cusp manifold inside of mom complexity n. So therefore, that's when I mentioned the person's this is actually a pretty good measure of complexity. Anyway, here's a little theorem of Peter Miller's that says if you look at, say, that a manifold has volume 0.93 and contained by filling non-manifold equals three manifolds, then that manifold is the least manifold. And, well, again, it's based on understanding, you know, more concretely fillings of topology fillings generated by certain seminal work. But it uses sort of more modern technology, which, well, in the modern form, it's by Fudo, Calciani, Purcell, Snappy, Snap, et cetera, and Harry Moser, Rigor, and such. But these guys, in turn, it's based on Gromov's Thurston 2 pi theorem, the work of Bessel, Courtois, Gallo, and stuff you're looking for. So therefore, we need to find all the monomers equal to three manifolds. And, here's the theorem that we proved, is that if you have a complete one cluster of manifold, volume less than equal 2.848, then this manifold is obtained by filling one mom through a mom three manifold. In fact, there's only three mom two manifolds and 18 mom three manifolds. So anyway, out of time, but let me just quickly say that it's really that, you know, just to get the intuition at least what to do, it's really that understanding of the picture, because you could just staring at the picture, you could see how, look at that. I mean, here's just two different points of view of the same thing, where here is, here, this is why I have to stare at the picture for a long time, but this is sort of showing how to see the mom manifold in sitting inside of it. So here you see this one plus manifold, but sitting inside of it is this mom two manifold. And here's, here you see these labels 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, whatever. But you're right. So the point is, like, remember, the fundamental group is acting here. So if you see this edge of 1, that means you're taking out a fundamental group. This 1 is moving here, and there's a vertical 1. And 2, this edge here, this 2 handle here, is the same as this one here under the fundamental group. And so you see that this 1 handle, label 1, 1 handle, label 1, 1 handle, label 2. So these 2 handles are going over these 1 handles. And so anyway, there's this, actually makes this all into sort of here, the rush, you see, you know, the blurring for your eyes, sort of this theory. But ultimately, you know, you see these things, and you might go, oh, it's obvious, here's where they are, but what looks like a handle structure when you project it out to a manifold PMS, you have to deal with such, and you can deal with it. And anyway, just to close, maybe just to just mention two questions. Well, first of all, there's this multitude of questions about low-volume manifolds topologically and also number theoretically, but there's also just related questions about sort of totally the other direction. You know, what about, you know, manifolds that are ultra-large in many different senses? What's the sort of structure of such things? And if I understood what Bill was saying yesterday, you know, there's a question of what's the structure of the space of well, if you look at this, it's a three manifold. You think of it as vertices, there's some graph, two, there's maybe a directed edge where you have one, you know, one thing taken by filling the surgery, and another one, and certain just hanging above. Maybe there's like an interesting structure theory of those. And you might, you know, there's a model, we didn't talk about that. I mean, certain in his original discussion, and he talked about sort of the manifold that came by filling, this guy came by filling the three cusps of that one, and he called this one sort of maybe the grandmother, great grandmother of that one. So we sort of, you know, set up that term and just call these things sort of moms. So anyway, other questions? Yes.
You talked about this popularity to prove, did I get it right, that you use 30
well, of a group, and group led to a contradiction of one or two different types, and we had to use about 16,000 different words. So that all but seven regions were dispatched because of more than 16,000 words, but each word had corresponded to two types of contradictions. So we really did need about 32,000 tests, so to speak.
Can you
give us one of these reasons that you... The point is that if you have a shortest geodesic, then... And it has sort of a thick tube, then sort of a candidate for that is sort of vowel space, is sort of a translation, is a group generated by two generators, one generating sort of the shortest geodesic, another taking this side to sort of the nearest translate. So there's sort of three complex parameter space of such things, and actually by this point 0.00060 of Meyerhoff, that space is actually compact. So therefore there's sort of this C3's, rectangle C3's worth of possible parameter space of group elements, and for given one of those, you look at the group generated by sort of this translation here and sort of this translation here, and that group, well, maybe just look at some word, you know, take a simple translation here, well, that word might have a smaller translation length. So that's a contradiction to the fact that this guy over here to start with is the shortest geodesic. Or some word, if it's F, Mrs. G, like F, G, F, G or something, that guy might be out here, and that guy, well, its length might be sort of long, well, it might be sort of longish, but on the other hand, if you apply that translation length to the original guy, you might get a guy that's too close. So contradiction in terms of length and distance are the two types of contradictions.
More questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much.
To introduce our last speaker, Dan Kan, of Princeton University and Beijing University, among